So, yeah, Suzanne asked me to present some of my work to give you a context, perhaps an insight in the ecology of the work of our institute. And because I'm not here, we use a special tool of Skype that you can see my computer on the screen. And I show you my PowerPoint presentation of some of my projects now on screen. Okay. Suzanne told you, I'm artistic director of the International Institute for Murder and Hate Radio, where you saw the movie you saw before, was one play we made in 2009-10, and then came out as a movie in the play in 2011, and as a radio play in 2014, and as a book also in 2014. So what we are trying to do is always producing our plays in very different formats. So, and yesterday we had the premiere of Empire, third part of the Europe trilogy, which I will also present to you. But let's start with some general thoughts about our work. So, first of all, I want to give you a sentence. And realism doesn't mean that something real is represented. Realism means that the representation itself becomes real. And of course, it's by the way, a quote of Godard. I never found it in a film or an interview of Godard, but I'm sure that it is from him. And I don't know about it. But my work is quite important quote. Because I don't think that, for example, when you're dealing with violence, how to bring violence on stage, then classical realism or classical naturalism is a very difficult tool. Because you can't represent, for example, mass murder on stage. How to show, and I think Hitler is dealing with that, how to show the tragedy of a people of 10 million persons, 100,000 perpetrators, and millions of victims. How can you show that on the 100 square meters of a normal stage? What would be the part you choose to do, and how this part can become in a Hegelian way part of the history itself? How subjective, how the small thing can become the big thing, and how you can represent something in the representation. It becomes real itself for the spectators, of course, but also for the actors, and also perhaps for the political situation within it happens, the representation of the movie or of the play. So, next, here we are. This is a manifesto I published in 2007. When I started to work on we founded the IIPM, and the question is on this manifesto is, was ist Kunst? Unst is Kunst without K. So what would be this new art of political, this new kind of political art to which could represent our times? What could be a new realism? Yeah? And it's here we are, and it's a discussion between a master of Unst and a scholar of Unst. So always question answer. One question the scholar is asking: what does the artist deliver for society? So artist without A, and the answer of the master of Unst is that it is the most repetition of the present. From the past for the future. It seems, I mean, that this is perhaps the formula for every realism, but I will try to explain it through some projects we made in the last 6 years. So the first one is the Last Days of the Chargescus. It was a project we did directly for Hate Radio, and I think it's discussable if Hate Radio is a reenactment or it's more a fictional play. We can perhaps talk about it later, but for the last is of the Chargescus, I would say it's a is really a reenactment. So representation, recreation of something that happened at a very specific moment in a very specific room. And it's the trial and the shooting of the Ceausescus, of the couple of the Ceausescus in December 1989 in Romania during the revolution. So these very known pictures, these iconic pictures of that trial that became one of the five most known video brands in my generation, and the older generations, the younger generations, it's not the same. We made some lectures about this project, so when we also made a movie for cinema out of it, and then I was quite impressed how the collective memory is changing for generations. But in the beginning of the new century, it was one with the landing on the moon, with the fall of the Twin Towers, with the shooting of the Kennedys. This picture was one of these five iconic pictures everybody knew, even if it's not Romanian, if it's not living there, etc. And I saw it also in television when I was 12 years old. So I was interested to remake it, and I remade it. You see on the right, a bit in the same style like Hate Radio. I made a casting in Romania and I casted very known Romanian actors from television and from the movies. Perhaps you know that the Nouvelle Vague, the Romanian Nouvelle Vague, all these art house movies they produced. And I was interested to show these very prominent actors, but the roles of Elena Nicolae Ceausescu. And that's what we did. And we enacted the whole trial from the beginning to the end in a kind of a reconstruction of that trial room. And here you can see how you have to change a bit the setting. Of course, the setting is bigger. There are less persons in the room than there were in the historic moment. And perhaps the most, for me, important changing was the colors in the room are quite different than the colors you can see here. Of course, I was in my research, I was there, I saw the room where it really happened. It's 1 hour political military trial against the Ceausescus. But the colors were very yellowish, very more white than you can see it here. But the problem is that the only video you have of it was made by these old 80s video cameras. They existed at that moment in Romania. They made the picture you can see high on the left. So I decided to use the colors of the video. I decided also to use, because the perspective of the video cameraman gave the impression that they are in that angle, but in the reality they were on the left angle. But I also decided to use this angle. So I made, let's say, a connection between reality and media memory you have of this picture. The shooting itself, that happened in reality like 1 minute after the trial, really behind the scene. So you can't see how they were shot. By the way, you can't also see it in the historical video, because the video was interrupted, and as you can imagine, there was a lot of paranoid ideas that they were shot, the other people were shot, and blah, blah, the normal things. And I said that the artist, what he does, just a moment back, the repetition of the present from the past for the future. When we presented it in Romania, display, everybody read it as a description of nowadays politics in Romania, because all the people you can see, except the Ceausescus, they were shot, you can see in this picture. It was the first time that you could see it like in 180 degrees perspective open. Because normally the picture is just what you can see on the left eye, only these two figures. And the rest of the people in the room you don't see. You don't know. And the first time they saw that everybody who is in that room is now, or was in the last 15 years, part of the Romanian government, in the one or in the other role as a minister, in the bureaucracy and so on, or are high economic leaders at the moment. So they understood that, in fact, what we are presenting, even if it's 25 years old, 20 years, and 2000 2009 when he did it in the National Theatre in Bucharest, his description of what is now happening. That you have an elite without break, from communists to Stalinists to Jesu times to our times, just being transformed, democratized and democratized and become the neoliberal elites of the economy. So this was like a transformation, talking about presence through the past, and then laughing around these classes to create a new future somehow. When you put Charest process means a trial term in your Google image searcher, then you will find most of the pictures. You will find will be pictures of the reenacting video. So the 10th picture perhaps will be the first picture that you find from the real trial, and the reenacting trial totally lets disappear the pictures of the real trial. And you can find it in a lot of, let's say, reenactment works. For example, Marina Abramovic makes very known 70s pieces, which we called with our last play 5 pieces. And she reenacted seven iconic moments or performances of the performance history. And because they were not really photographed at the moment, because it was really avant-gardistic and they happened somewhere in a little gallery and nobody was there to take pictures. And there are always some notes from the artists when they're searching, for example, for boys, in the Bodenhausen Bühler, that how to explain in dead rabbits the pictures that where boys has this golden mask, this dead rabbit in the arms explaining in the art. You don't find any picture of boys, you find only pictures of Marina Abramovic playing boys. And that's how in realistic art you can exchange pictures with stylistic times, strangely. Then another reenactment, which is not really one, I think, because it's very fictionalized. I don't remember if you can feel that in the movie. But we can talk later about it, that we modernized this radio station, and basically I put 1,000 hours together to make 1 hour. So while the Ceausescu trial really happened like I showed it, it's 1 hour and I reproduced this hour, this is a fictional, like a new 1 hour of this radio station. The research was quite the same. So I met everybody who survived. There is the Valerie Benedicti, I think you can see that in the movie. I met her several times, and there is Josh Kuchus, the white one, who survived from the hosts. And of course a lot of people, they listened to the radio station. For me, that's also very, very good, I think, in this TV feature, you saw that for me, the performance moment of it was to invite survivors or people they have a very direct political connection to what happened in 1941 to play these roles. So they are actors, but at the same time, they are Rwandan citizens, complete citizens, or people, or refugees from the time of the Civil War. And this idea to invite actors, they are professional actors, because it's a very difficult play to play in Israel. It's a quite difficult text also to perform, and it's quite difficult to do it in this way they do it in that class. But at the same point, for me, the legitimacy to do projects like this are directly linked to the fact that I work with people they know much more than I do. So they know what is right. And especially in the moment when I change details, and it's very difficult and very dangerous to change details. For example, when you're working on a genocide, you can become very fast so-called negationist. Then for me, it's both actors. Extremely important. And also, the moment you can see in the movie when you go to Rwanda to perform it there in the former studio of the RTLM, that people say it was exactly like this. yes, we remember it like this, but we forget about in this detail, this detail, change this. And finally, RTLM is more than RTLM, it is hate radio. The studio we made is based on what Valerie Bemerick explained me how it was and George Rucci, because there are no pictures at all of this station, but it's also as all studios look like, all radio the same. So it's also an iconic room. And in the last thing for me, it was important to represent the Rwandan genocide. I think that the Rwandan genocide is one of the main lines of talking about mass violence, one of the events. And there is about this event it became a rhetoric which pictures we use only always in every we have the magic these tools used to pick. At that time, they use the skulls, they use a lot of pictures we decided from the beginning on not to use. So we can find nothing that is in the normal, like what they want in the normal films, in big films made about the genocide. We didn't use it at all. That's why it was a decision. Of course, we started on using it, but then we decided to give a totally other picture that doesn't look like Africa. One time we made an exhibition of the project I think it's in Austria, or it was in France, I don't remember, of course, but the people they came in and they didn't understand Kinyarwanda, of course, or the local language they talked in the studio, they didn't understand it was about the genocide, but they thought that it was just a radio studio from our time. It did look a bit strange, but not too strange that it couldn't. So for me, it was extremely important to postmodernize it, to globalize this station, to not make a movie or a play about Africa, but about the 90s. So, and about the certain generation, the March generation, that I, very influenced, for example, by the movies of Nova and Sonic Youth, how they move, how this strange melange of history and epic moments, they are very grungy, these people. And of course, the real RTLM was not so grungy as radio. But let's step to another. This is Breivik. And Breivik, the mass murderer, the right wing terrorist who killed these 80 people. It was at the very moment when you were rehearsing for hate radio that happened. I don't remember it when I read it. And then appeared this manifesto, a huge copy-paste compendium, he explains why he did what he did. And then at the moment I was a guest professor in Leipzig, and one of my students told me that he had a 12 pages version, Breivik used as a speech before the tribunal he had in 2012. And it wasn't published at all, it was not broadcasted, but the author of this student was a journalist in the tribunal. And she took, she registered it on audio on her iPhone, and then he made a transliteration for me, a transcription, and I translated it in German, and then I asked my actress, Sascha Soylan, to read it. And we read it in several cities, and that was just a reading. And it was extremely interesting to see also this very possible melange he made from right-wing and left-wing, a lot of left-wing idéfix to explain why the situation was come to do what he did. And we did it like for 3 years in a lot of different places. Also this one you can discuss if it's a reenactment or if it's a lecture, and what is theatrical and what not, and what is if it's a work more about listening or talking, and it's a work about the rhetorics of Breivik. A very different line of projects we made start with the Moscow trials. And there I was interested in to, let's say, more or less to represent violence in society or social antagonisms in society, not directly on representing or reenacting it or making a fictional story about it, but to restage it in the form of trial. So the Moscow trials, he made in Moscow in 2013, and the movie came out in 2014. He staged again the trial against the Pussy Riot and against some other curators at that moment in the camps or in prison, because they were dissidents or they were in the eyes of the Russian justice aggressing the feelings of Orthodox believers. So you can see Katya from Pussy Riot. And on the right, on the first picture on the right, there is the advocate. He was advocate in the Pussy Riot case and also in our case. And we invited a popular jury, and everybody in the room was real. So we invited all the real experts, all the real, and we real judges. And the real and real jury. And that we made restaged the three files with an open ending. So I mean, it's quite the opposite of what we did in the last days of the judges. It's to restage an epilepsy on in a kind of a utopic place where justice really can happen. Yeah, so, okay. I think time is running out, I'll go faster. The last, we did several trials like this. The last we did was Tribunal sur le Congo, the Congo Tribunal. We did in East Congo. And here, I think concerning violence and mass deportations and also economic violence, it was the most, the biggest work we did till now. So this is Bando, one Canadian corporation, gold corporation. They come to Eastern Congo, the in minerals most rich place in the world, in cocaine, in gold, and they deport people somewhere else to bring that gold out, with the help of the UN, with the help of the World Bank, with the help of the local government, and so on. So it's really, we try to make a kind of work about what is globalization, what is this in three particular cases. So we put, there's a civil war against, around these regions with 50 million dead. By the way, a civil war that started after the genocide in Rwanda, when the genocide there, so that the killers went over the frontier to the Congo. And so we made a choice of three cases, one massacre and two mass deportations of local Mayans. And the very same style like in Moscow trial, we tried to bring this huge civil war, this huge economic world war, because China is in there, the US is in there, Canada, Switzerland, Europe, Belgium, Holland, I don't know. But every country is in there because there's only a way you can find, for example, vocabulary that you use for the IT industry. We tried to bring this in a trial room in one of the cities of this city was rich in Bukhari, which is on the Lake Kivu. And also with a different, with what you call champ mix, so with addressing charges from Den Haag. For example, this is Jean-Louis Zen, who's working in the Aragon of the Founders. And on the left, you have Meta Vizindra, who is the leader of the Advocate Society of the Democratic Republic of Congo. And in per se style, process eliminations, speeches, real experts, and compared to Moscow, we had a very difficult program of anonymization. For example, this is Repo. So we gave him a kind of a book, we changed the voice, and we made a new trial, how stay on made in Denmark, for example. Just, of course, did not get cross explanations, for example, or jury, or all that things is a melange of different ways of justice. They don't exist in that way before we made these drugs. And with a judgment against the UN, against the local governments, against the huge corporations. So, also trying to represent, how you can represent 6 million people reported and killed in 3 days. How can it be if you talk about being in that end? So bringing justice. This was the let's say when for example hate review and the last days of Chavez are nihilistic in a way or fatalistic. This is the other way around, a very utopic way of representing violence. That's it. Showing that you can overcome by justice. So yeah, these are the people we invited, the experts we invited for the Mutarunda case of the massacre, one of the three cases. You can see in the second row on the very right, you can see the leader of the UN mission. Very down in the middle, you have the Minister of Interior, who organized the massacre. Then you have on his right side, you have Vital Kamerhe. I hope the president ended from the opposition, and the most persons are four survivors of the massacre. So we invited everybody who was involved, and always I'm quite impressed that all these people really showed up. This is also a question we can perhaps discuss, how can it be that they really participate? What do they expect? What can they win, for example, the minister, for example, the head of the UN, because they really did a very, very bad job. It's a bit comparable to surveillance, that the UN was just at the side, even retiring their troops in the moment when everything started. So it's really the same sample of peacekeeping politics they look for. So very fast today, a third line of our work when hatred and classes of the Chavezes in a way is representation. And the trials are in a way repetition. This is just presentation. Always inviting on the left of the symbol, also the writing of the second part called the Dark Ages, yesterday the Premier with Empire, third part. And always we invite four or five actors telling on stage their story of mostly violence. For example, Dark Ages, there you have five people telling about from the bombing of the German cities in the Second World War, two Sarajevo War, two the Bosnian War, two the bombing, the NATO bombing of Belgrade until now. So it ends with the trial against Krajcik. So it's like the war history of Europe. The third part is about the Syrian War, about Europe and on Europe borders, through the eyes of what I would call actor witnesses, because these are all actors, except one, only one person. They are all actors, sometimes very well known, very, very star actors, but not playing theater or movies, but tell their own story. So becoming an example, very, very, very intimate at the same moment. And to end, this is not maybe my compassion history of machine, but fast on me. It was about the health industry, the NGO industry, how Europe and Africa in that case is linked through the NGOs. Because during my research, I was always in one hand impressed and the other hand depressed by the work of the NGOs, of this kind of compassive neocolonialism you can see, for example, in the Burundian Central African region. And I invited one actress from the Schaubühne in Berlin, Osama Ladi, and Consulat Sipelius, who's a survivor of the genocide in Burundi that happened right before the genocide in Rwanda. But at this time, from the because Burundi is like the mirror of Rwanda. But there you have at the moment in '90s, now it changed. But at that very moment in '93, you had a Tutsi majority and a Hutu minority, and Tutsi killed Hutu, if you want. So I mean, it was very, much more difficult. But it was like the beginning of what happened the other way around in Rwanda the next year. This play, I used to ask perhaps the most important question when we're dealing about violence and witnessing on stage in movies. What does it mean to witness on stage? And what is the difference between being yourself on stage or in a movie or being an actor on stage in a movie? Because one actor is playing the NGO person and the other is telling their own story, and in a second, in a moment in the play, it begins to blur. Everything begins to blur. Don't know. I mean, it's a very possible question: what's real, what's fiction. But for me, it is one question that came out in all my travels and research trips and my work. How do you produce authentic pictures, for example? Because the witness is authentic. Because it is true documented, where comes the fiction? And how do you bring facts on stage in the movie? What is this transformation? And the last one, it was in Utrecht, perhaps some of you saw it, was Five Easy Pieces. And here my question was, what happens when you let play children violence, grief, and rebellion in the end, so things you don't want to see from children. Because normally there is like a rule, there is a children world that is fiction and there is the truth, the reality, and this is for adults only. And this was another way to reflect on that story. What does it mean to reenact, to play violence and the bad feelings on stage. So I hope you can understand it through Skype. And that was it for the moment. Thank you.